Please welcome the president and CEO of the College Board, David Coleman.
So, these are the pages with President Brodhead's vita, all his achievements in life, and all that you can find out about him from the external world. He has asked me as a courtesy to dispense with these, because he's sick of hearing his introductory biography. So I shall respect him in this and take out this piece of paper, which has other things on it. I first met, in a sense, virtually as we do in this day and age, actually over the telephone, President Brodhead, when I had recently finished drafting the standards in literacy together with my team, and he was then the chair of the National Humanities Council that has been recently, you know, the heart of the matter, you know this work, celebrating the humanities. And that is typically a very intimidating call because, you know, we had constructed these standards for K-12. You're now talking to higher education. And while we had consulted with higher education a great deal along the way, I had long known and admired him from his work because I was a student at Yale when he was a professor there. And what struck me, I immediately connected with him in this kind of weirdly fluent way. And the author who was writing the report was really peeved at both of us because we would race out in all sorts of directions while she was trying. You can imagine this, I imagine. But there was something about him that I found extremely rare. And I was trying to capture a quality about his mind and his action. And so I decided to go to a source that he would recognize, but perhaps not expect. This is an excerpt from a somewhat famous book by Melville, the big one, in which you might say he writes an apology for, not for what he should have apologized for, which is the length of the book to follow, but rather for its subject, which was quite ordinary people in what was such an epic thing. You know, not Achilles, but these mariners, these seafarers, the kind of low-life types. And he writes this paragraph that I almost am certain you know by heart, so you could probably recite with me. And he writes this. And so this is the author speaking directly to the reader, okay? Anticipating the bad reviews he's gonna get for writing this book. And he says, "If then, to meanest mariners and renegades and castaways, I shall hereafter ascribe high qualities, though dark. Weave round them tragic graces. If even the most mournful, perchance the most abased among them all, shall at times lift himself to the exalted mounts. If I shall touch that workman's arm with some ethereal light. If I shall spread a rainbow over his disastrous set of sun. Then against all mortal critics bear me out in it. Thou just spirit of equality, which is spread one royal mantle of humanity over all my kind. Bear me out in it, thou great democratic God." It is a beautiful thing when a man as learned as Dick Brodhead is such a democrat, has such an ease in talking about regular life and regular people, such an obvious interest in the daily lives most of us lead, despite his exquisite appreciation of literature, despite being the Devane professor at Yale, despite being involved in the turnaround quietly of Yale that he was involved in as dean, which was not in as great a shape as you might think when he found it, but he left it gleaming. But this guy who could be so apart in the academy did not in his life book write a small book or a hermetic book. He wrote in a big-hearted way a big book where you just get a sense talking about reading that it's something he sees in every person's life. It's an appetite he believes sincerely can be awakened in all of us. And so, as a democratic person, I don't mean Republican or Democrat, but to have Democrat in a much deeper sense, in a deeply democratic person, what does he do when he goes to Duke, leaving the kind of ivory scenery of Yale? He immediately starts work on a global health division, which takes science to deliver breakthroughs in global health across the globe. Isn't that interesting, where the humanist becomes interested in science and social science and action? But I think that's because the democratic quality was always present in his reading and his writing. He, by the way, is a scholar of Melville, which is why he knows this by heart. And so he's the only one in this audience who's now not allowed to answer the question I want to ask next, which is, who does Melville inscribe Moby Dick to? He raised his hand. Nice try. Anyone else? Shout it out. Nathaniel Hawthorne. It is a remarkable thing that the great authors of every age find one another, even if they are not famous. They find one another, they see each other in their work. It's great, we see this again and again. And so I thought, as a way, it's brought on a little more emotion than I expected. It is very meaningful to me that he traveled here, as busy as he is, on this first year of my presidency. I consider it quite a personal expression of affection and care and support. And so as a way of thanking him, I thought I would try to describe what that feels like, and I shall choose a paragraph from the book you might expect me to, which is The Scarlet Letter. And if those of you remember the beginning of that book, there's an opening episode and then a strange again moment, almost like in the moment of Moby Dick, where the author seems to reach right out towards the reader, just as Melville reached out to us. And he says, again famously, this rosebush, so he's describing a rosebush in front of a prison, this rosebush, by a strange chance, has been kept alive in history. But whether it had merely survived out of the stern old wilderness, so long after the fall of the gigantic pines and oaks that originally overshadowed it, or whether, as there is fair authority for believing, it had sprung up under the footsteps of the sainted Anne Hutchinson as she entered the prison door, we shall not take upon us to determine. Finding it so directly on the threshold of our narrative, which is now about to take issue from that inauspicious portal, we could hardly do otherwise than pluck one of its flowers and present it to the reader. It may serve, let us hope, to symbolize some sweet moral blossom that may be found along the track or relieve the darkening close of a tale of human frailty and sorrow. You coming here is like offering me that kind of rose and that kind of support through whatever difficult things we navigate and hard things. I consider his presence an inspiration and support for the work we're doing. And it was just like after having finished writing The Standards, when I saw someone who I so regarded resonate with the work he found within him and find it so urgent that all kids analytically wrote, as we learned about this morning, that he shared the urgency of the finest high school teacher about kids within her care, that this august college president and scholar had that democratic leaning. It, to me, is the finest example of what a leader in higher education can be, at once a scholar, but ruthlessly democratic and open, and open to the possibilities of others. Thank you. With that, I introduce you.
You hear the famous song? Not everyone perhaps knows that that was the Blue Devil fight song that was being played as I came in here, which was presumably designed to purge your mind of the extraordinary evocation of me, which leaves the real me so pathetically inadequate in comparison. I've never heard myself called a Democrat so many times, and when I go back to North Carolina, I will have some splainin' to do. My friends, I am honored to have a chance to speak today to the College Board Forum, and David, I am especially pleased to have a chance to speak in the first year of what I know will be your long and happy reign. And to my audience of everyone in this room, I say to you, you perform one of the most significant functions in American life, and I salute you. Since the military draft ended 40 years ago, the chief experience that Americans of many different backgrounds go through together as an age cohort is the college admissions process. In that great transition, you are the border patrols and you are the crossing guards. As secondary school leaders and college guidance counselors, you urge students forward, you help them visualize their options, you encourage them to present their accomplishments in compelling yet truthful lights. Those of you on the college and university side enlighten students about what college is. We assume everyone knows, but of course people don't, what it is and why it matters. You help people make the finances work, and then you select and shape an admitted class. Put it all together, and the scale of the process is somewhat astounding. I am told that of the 3.2 million young people who graduated from high school in the year 2012, 2.1 million, or 66%, were enrolled in college of some sort in that fall. Now, it matters profoundly how well this transition is managed. It matters to individual students and their families who regard you as holding the keys to life and death, and it also matters to our nation. Our wisdom and productivity in future are directly dependent on whether in earlier life the greatest possible number of men and women get the education that lets them live up to their potential. If quality higher education is richly available in this country, we will be prepared for any future. And if people don't get the full measure of enablement through education, we will lose some measure of their potential, and we will all pay a price. Now, deployed as you are along this charged perimeter, not exactly a demilitarized zone, but it is indeed a charged perimeter, you guys are uniquely equipped to register the hopes and dreams that drive the quest for college admission. And equally, you guys are uniquely equipped to register the negative emotions that have been so significantly strengthened in recent years. Tell me if you think I'm wrong, and my impression is, never has college been sought with the same desperate eagerness as the route to fulfillment and success that it is today, and never has there been so much cynicism and mistrust along the way. You know the litany. College is the only hope, but college costs too much. You can borrow money to help pay the cost, but then you're saddled with disabling debt. Some colleges admit students who have no realistic chance of completion, and they end up with the worst of both worlds. They get the debt, but they don't get the degree. But it is implied that some who do get the degree may fare a little better. You all remember when the book Academically Adrift came out last year with its suggestion that there were large numbers of students who perhaps learned nothing at all in college or maybe even went backward in their knowledge. Wasn't it astonishing how the media hastened to grab onto that result almost with a kind of gleefulness? If what that book says is true, then students graduating from college, if they actually are no better trained than they were when they went in, they will have no better shot at quality employment when they graduate. And so what will it have availed them? As I trust you know, this litany represents a mix of true facts and astonishing wild distortion. In sober truth, unemployment is significantly lower and lifelong earnings are significantly higher for four-year college graduates. The College Board has demonstrated this, the U.S. Census has demonstrated it. The fact is utterly beyond dispute. But media organs tend to prefer the lurid version of the tale, and their repetitions have come close to establishing the lurid version as a self-evident truth. My favorite was this. In May 2012, right around the weekend that's graduation weekend for probably the majority of American colleges, the Sunday New York Times ran a lead story featuring a student who just graduated from a four-year liberal arts college who emerged with debt of $120,000. Do you remember this story? This person was working two jobs in fast food joints to help pay off her debt, and perhaps even more ghastly, we learned that her mother had taken out an insurance policy on the child so that if the child died, the mother would not become liable for her unpaid loans. Right there on page one of the paper of the Journal of First Report in this country, the poster child for college education in the scammy days of cost, debt, unemployment, and disablement. It was only in the sixth paragraph of the story that it was reported that the average indebtedness of people graduating from four-year schools was a figure in the 20,000 range, that's to say one-sixth the amount that the front page or first paragraph had made seem typical. Now, as you also know, however, the new negativism that's a new fact of our life isn't solely a media creation, if only it were. At bottom, I take it, it's a byproduct of the economic downturn that was followed by a recovery that has lacked the true lift that usually follows accompanies recoveries, especially for the middle class. Barbara Ehrenreich long ago explained that the middle class is that class that can never amass enough wealth to secure its children's well-being through inheritance. So instead, the middle class is that class whose parents strive to assure their children's success by hyper-investing in education. Now, when the costs go up for families whose income is not going up, and when post-college employment prospects for their children grow somewhat dimmer, this strategy comes under massive pressure at both ends of the equation, and the typical hopes that accompany it become shrouded with a sense of, I think this is the right word for it, the hope is shrouded with a sense of betrayal. We read one result in the rush of our public elected officials to hold higher education accountable for the value it no longer seems to deliver. Remember when President Obama went on a virtual campaign tour this past summer to connect with the hopes and fears of the public? The issue he chose was preaching federal accountability for higher education. After the State of the Union address last January, I went on the website, I bet you did too, the Obama administration issued report cards measuring the real cost of attendance, debt rates, and completion rates for every institution of higher education. Virginia law now requires all institutions to post the starting salaries for their graduates broken down by college major so that parents can know what course of study leads to what result. The anxiety that higher education may not lead to a secure, prosperous future, I take that to be the great new fact of our time. There's no wishing it away. If we're living through a structural change in the distribution of wealth and opportunity in our culture, and many fear that we are, this new reality could be with us for a long time. And in this new circumstance, we all have work to do, work to mitigate cost increases in higher education, and work to teach the public the real facts of price and choice. But that's not the end of the challenge we face. Now, I'm trying to indicate this next paragraph in italics, so it will be sure to burn itself in your mind so recently burned into by the quotes from Melville and Hawthorne. But that's not the only challenge we face. A peculiarity of recent years is that as the debate over the value of college has grown more heated, the concept of this value has grown more narrow, indeed, I think, quite impoverished. The White House website will tell you the effective cost of attending Dartmouth or Arizona State or the school of your choice, and that is useful information, except it leaves the lingering impression that the value of a college education is identical with the price. The Virginia website makes it easy to calculate the benefit derived from attending any institution in that state, provided you assume the benefit equals the salary paid by your first employer. As these somewhat reductive metrics gain ground around us, the friends of higher education have a job to do. Without ignoring or minimizing economic realities, we need to say loud and clear what the value of a good education actually consists of. Now, there are many different versions of post-secondary education, some of which do involve learning specific workplace skills, and those may be adequately measured by near-term employment statistics or rates of pay. But much of higher education draws on some version of a liberal arts model, and it has an altogether different value proposition. I'm telling you something I hope you already know and agree with. It would be this. Liberal arts education isn't just a matter of requiring students to visit random curricular domains and check the curricular boxes. Beyond its formal requirement, liberal arts education aims to engage multiple forms of intelligence to create deep and enduring habits of mind, an active, integrative, versatile spirit that's naturally disposed when it comes to any new fact or situation to use what it already knows to try to grasp that new fact and then use that new fact and that new understanding to update pre-existing understandings in that new light. The value of this habit of mind isn't measured by income alone. What is the value of this habit of mind? It is, in the fullest sense, equipment for living. Its value is that it supplies enrichment for personal lives, equips students to be thoughtful and constructive social contributors, and prepares them to participate fully and creatively and adaptively in the dynamic, ever-changing world that awaits them after college. Easy for me to see why people might be anxious about something so difficult to calculate. Easy to see why they might prefer a straighter line between the input and the payoff. But the fruits of the kind of education I'm describing can truthfully only be reckoned over long time horizons as they enable people to rise to challenges and seize opportunities they couldn't foresee at the time of their education. The lives, I tried to think of some examples and I really couldn't think of any. The lives of successful people almost never involve continuing to do the thing they prepared for in early life. As their lives unfold, successful people find that by drawing on their preparation in unexpected ways, they are empowered to do things they hadn't intended or probably even imagined at the time their education took place. That's what I mean by equipment for living. Now, I'm describing a situation where, thinking they're setting out to secure real value from education, people may in fact be tempted to pursue narrow and short-sighted versions of that value, and so shortchange themselves in the act of being apparently shrewd. One favorite target of those who want more bang for the educational buck is the humanities. This could be no secret to you. All federal investments in research have been constrained in the days of high deficits and sequestration, but humanities budgets are always the ones that are cut disproportionately. Between 2010 and 2013, appropriation for the National Endowment for the Humanities was cut 16%. In those same years, allocation for Title VI, that's the federal program that supports foreign language programs, that program was cut a whopping 44% at that time. Shortly after his election, the governor of my state said that public dollars should support only that higher education that leads straight to jobs, and that if students want to study more rarefied subjects, they should do so at their own expense at private institutions. Now, as David mentioned, or I think he at least implied this, this is my 10th year as the president of Duke, but I started life as an English teacher, and at heart, anyone who knows me knows that's what I still am at heart. At present, I'm involved in a campaign to promote the value of the liberal arts and the humanities, and I thought I might spend my time today telling a few stories from this little adventure that I've been on. The story starts more than 10 years back, and you'll remember this. At the request of two senators and two members of the House of Representatives, the National Academies commissioned a report that was eventually titled Rising Above the Gathering Storm. That report made an urgent and cogent case that to prevent a disastrous loss of competitiveness in a global economy, America needed to strengthen its training in the fields of science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. It's a measure of that report's success that STEM, the acronym of that field, is now a household word. People don't even remember that word was not invented by Adam and Eve. A measure of that report that STEM is now a household word and that large bipartisan majorities funded its priorities when the America Competes Act came up in the second Bush administration. Now, no one I know doubts the need for STEM initiatives, but one can ask whether the nation's needs can be met through STEM alone. When the National Research Council commissioned a new report on research universities focused solely on STEM fields, I wrote some people and voiced the thought that the humanities and social sciences should be talked about too, since those are also important aspects of what universities do. That didn't happen, but about a year later, with its own charge from two senators and two congressmen, the American Academy of Arts and Sciences launched a commission on the humanities and social sciences, and for my sins, I was asked to be the chair. Now, inviting people to serve on this commission was one of the most fun things I've ever done, even more fun than inviting people to birthday parties. We eventually asked 55 extraordinarily talented and busy people, and all but one of them almost instantly accepted. And they said they accepted because they recognized that this task was important, and they recognized that it would be well worth whatever time it took from them. Among many others, the commission included the presidents of Harvard, Stanford, Penn, Notre Dame, the Chancellor of UC Berkeley, the Chancellor of the University of Texas System, and the head of the nation's largest community college, but it also, and importantly, included business leaders, military leaders, a former governor, a federal judge, the heads of major libraries and art museums, an actor, John Lithgow, a filmmaker, George Lucas, an architect, Billy Shen. We had them all. Over a year and a half, this commission met for a series of highly engaging conversations, and what was so interesting about the conversations was that the very most eloquent voices on behalf of the humanities and liberal arts did not come from the academics, we all do that for a living, they came from the non-academics on the panel. James McNerney is the CEO of Boeing, a regular attender of our meetings. He said, high-tech manufacturing requires skilled engineers, but beyond a certain level, people won't advance in his company if they don't have a broader array of skills, especially skills of communication and interacting with culturally diverse others. And what is that? Liberal arts training par excellence. Another of our members was General Carl Eikenberry, who we can also call Ambassador Carl Eikenberry. He was headed both the military and diplomatic efforts in Afghanistan. At our commission, Carl Eikenberry testified that in the globalized modern world, you can't buy enough weapons to take care of the needs of national security. Weapons can only do so much, and there are problems that need to be solved at other levels, at levels that involve things like understanding foreign languages, understanding foreign histories and cultures, understanding different belief systems and ethical systems different from one's own. These are classical humanities fields that people learn as part of a liberal arts education. Some of you will know the name of Norm Augustine. For a long time, he was the head of Lockheed Martin, and he was really the spiritual father of the Gathering Storm Report. He argued at our commission that collecting evidence, weighing interpretations, and making arguments are just plain core skills for creative workers and good citizens, and that these require broad training across the sciences and humanities. Norm Augustine, the father of STEM, said he thought the single field in which American education is currently most deficient is neither science, nor engineering, nor technology, nor math, but rather history. And he pointed to history as a prime teacher of the array of skills I just mentioned. One last example, Eduardo Padron, the president of Miami-Dade College, reminded us very usefully that one-third of America's undergraduates are in community colleges where their aims are by no means exclusively technical. Miami-Dade serves 175,000 students, 90% of them minority, 60% of them low income, the great majority of them immigrants or first generation. As Padron said, we take the people who can't pay or be admitted elsewhere. But even when these students seek training for a particular job, it's the broader training they receive that typically helps them to their next job, with Miami-Dade's liberal arts curriculum launching thousands into second careers as public servants, lawyers, businessmen, and teachers. Here's a quote from Padron. If there's one area where the social sciences and the humanities are most important, more than in the Ivy League, more than at the Smithsonian, it's right here in community colleges where the masses of Americans have their first chance to achieve the American dream. In addition to all these arguments in favor of the utility of humanistic training, I think I should also just add, all members of the committee from all different sectors believe that the main reason to study the humanities is because it broadens and deepens human awareness. Humans are the only species capable of entering into the hopes, fears, striving, and wisdom gained by other humans across time and space, a radically enhanced experience available to us, for instance, through art, through music, through the written word, through film, and other sources. As humans, we have the incredible power to see things, to feel things, to know things we could never have grasped on our own by being able to enter into the transmitted imagination of others, a magnificent expansion of consciousness. We turn our back on this legacy at the cost of condemning ourselves to the harshest of all known poverties, the poverty of imprisonment in our narrow present, equipped with only our own unaided light. So, after many months, it was really almost a year and a half, of teaching and learning from each other, this summer the commission had reached a sufficient point of agreement that we put out a report of our own, which, as I hope you know, was entitled The Heart of the Matter. Like the report that launched the STEM Crusade, this one aims to make a compelling argument for the public need for the humanities and to outline practical steps to advance the cause. The report makes the case that the humanities require support along the whole arc from K through 12 through college into community cultural life and lifelong learning. And it especially makes the case that the separate parts of this effort will each be more effective if they work more carefully together. So, Just quickly to talk about the recommendations, the heart of the matter first calls for a deepened commitment to literacy, and here I'll read a few lines from the report. Reading and writing are the building blocks of learning, making possible all the rest of our education and development. From being able to sound out words on a page, we are advanced to be able to analyze, interpret, ask questions, make connections, and express our thoughts in words. And worth underlining, even in a digital age, the spoken and written word remain the most basic unit of interaction and the basis of our humanity. The committee felt this ever so strongly. No point talking about the development of the humanities in later life if you have not supplied the foundation of literacy in the earliest levels of education. Now, by a kind of amazing coincidence that has made David and me feel that our friendship was born under providential sign, the Common Core Standards Initiative emerged from the National Governors Association just while we were in the middle of having our deliberations. Now, my commission does not pretend to be experts in K through 12 education, but we recognize the Common Core as an attempt to institutionalize just the kind of deeper version of literacy we're talking about, a version where learning to read is not the end or goal, but the beginning of an unfolding process of interrogating the world and building critical thinking skills. It's our hope, as I know it is the College Board's, that started early and continued systematically from year to year, this approach will bring many more students to the end of high school prepared for the higher order work they'll be asked to do in college. We were forewarned that when the Common Core standards were introduced, test scores would go down. But I think we believed that this still would be the right road if it led to deeper enablement for many more people. I had a chance at the first meeting where I learned the prediction that test scores would go down under the Common Core. One of the speakers was Bob Wise, who used to be the governor of West Virginia. And I asked him, well, how are people supposed to understand that the scores are suddenly going down? And he said this. He said, when I was in high school, I played football, and our coach would sometimes make us lift heavier weights. And at first, it was very hard to do it, but after a while, that made us stronger. I'd have to say, I assume that this is the point of asking people to meet higher standards, not that it will be easy to meet them right away, but that it will lead you through the process of strengthening that leads you to a higher place eventually. Second, a broad cumulative development of powers rooted in literacy isn't going to work without teachers who can live up to that expectation. So as we raise the literacy bar, our report also calls for a parallel emphasis on teacher training. This is a place where collaboration between high school and college and university teachers is badly needed. These two segments of our except perhaps this room being an exception, these two segments of our educational system are commonly separate worlds, each absorbed in its own absorbing task, but it's hard to see how high school results are going to be better aligned with college education if the two halves don't begin talking to each other from an earlier stage. And furthermore, higher education can help provide resources to enrich curricula and enrich ways of approaching that curriculum in high school instruction. 10 miles down the road from Duke in North Carolina lies the National Humanities Center. This is, you know, when you go there, it's like a monastery. It's a refuge for scholarly reflection and research. But importantly, it also has spearheaded a major outreach program to high school teachers through online seminars and through the toolkits it offers of primary materials that can be used in historical inquiry. The different segments of our educational community are all going to be stronger when we see more of such cooperation across institutional bounds. Now, at the next level, I'm talking now about college and university, our report is mindful that the distinctive American strength in higher education, a strength that's envied and admired around the world, and that people in several Asian countries are trying to figure out how to replicate, the distinctive American strength in higher education is based on a plan that opens minds in multiple directions, engages curiosity in a variety of ways, and puts us in a position to synthesize separate bits of knowledge into new insights. This broad, integrative training that reaches across the arts and sciences, that's America's alternative to the early specialization that's the norm in most countries in the world. And it is widely believed that it's that form of education that supports the habits of nimbleness, innovativeness, and creative versatility that give the American economy its dynamism and its edge. Public understanding of this model of education may be eroding at the very moment when this form of education will be more valuable than ever. And if that is so, no wonder the report calls for colleges and universities to make a far greater effort than they now do to communicate the enabling power of liberal arts education, sharing this message as many ways as we can think to share it with as many publics as we can reach. And the report also calls on colleges and universities to make sure they maximally deliver on what they claim to provide. Specialized curricular offerings can be life-altering experiences for students and are one of the great luxuries of attending a great university. But if we're to lay claim to developing the broad-based integrative skills I've been describing, we have to take trouble to make sure we offer the courses that actually do that work, that train those habits of mind, and we have to help students understand how their course choices can build a thoughtful education rather than a random smattering of unconnected parts. We have a lot of other recommendations. The way you're going to learn about them is by going to the website, humanitiescommission.org, and you can read them all. You can underline them. You can write your comments in the margin. But I want, at this point, instead of enumerating further recommendations, I want to talk a little bit about our idea of tactics, how we're thinking we might have this report have some effect. Reports like the one my group worked on can lie around unread. Indeed, they usually do lie around unread. One of the most depressing parts of my commission was when somebody assembled for us all the prior commissions that had written on the very same subject. But reports of this sort also can make a difference, and that's what Gathering Storm was such an interesting example of. So as we wrote our report, we were most interested to talk to Norm Augustine and the other people on our commission who'd been on that commission to find out what had led to their success. What we learned was, even after they came up with a persuasive rationale, even after they came up with practical measures, there was a long interval spent carrying the message to multiple audiences before results began to take shape. We didn't foresee that, but it was an important lesson. And that's the stage I think we're at now. We were delighted that when this, the Heart of the Matter was launched this summer, it received very enthusiastic coverage across the media. Thousands of people visited the website. Tens of thousands of copies of the report have been downloaded. PBS NewsHour featured the report. The Colbert Report, memorably, perhaps the most important moment in the history of the modern humanities, featured the report to a TV audience. Papers around the country continue to publish op-eds and follow-on articles engaged with these ideas. And to me, all that is evidence that this report actually hit a nerve, in truth. It's not that hard a sell to remind people that literacy is the foundation of communication skills and analytical skills. It's not that hard a sell to remind people that citizens of a democracy need to have some functioning understanding of history to be good citizens. It's not that hard a sell to make the case that in a globalized world, it's dangerous to know as little about foreign people and cultures as we currently do. It's not that hard a sell to remind people that STEM is a crucial component of a balanced diet, but it's not the whole of what we need. And it's not that hard a sell to make the case that it's not only good for people to study humanistic subjects, but that humans naturally love and crave that kind of food. Why does the Museum of Modern Art have over 1 million followers on its Twitter feed? Why was Oprah able to mobilize the entire Oprah Book Club to read Anna Karenina, Faulkner, and Toni Morrison if there were not some primal hunger there? Why would it be that the Coursera professor who has had the highest enrollment to date has been a humanist? The philosophy professor, of course, at Duke, Walter Sinnott Armstrong, whose course called Think Again, How to Reason and Argue, has reached more than 400,000 people online. You get my point. So far from bearing an unpalatable message of the eat your broccoli mode, our commission has been telling people something they thought was actually pretty commonsensical, something that they already knew and believed, and would have been aware that they believed if our public discourse were not so clogged with other and contrary messages. Now, eventually, we're going to have to look to the federal government to play some role in supporting the humanities. this, I think, is probably not the most auspicious month in history to ask for large new federal appropriations. Ha, ha, ha. But for all that, the defunding of the National Endowment of the Humanities, which supports arts and history programs in every state in this country, is a scandalously short-sighted public policy. Restoring adequate funding for the study of foreign languages and cultures through Title VI and the Fulbright-Hays program is another extremely obvious goal. But unlike the sciences, the humanities aren't primarily dependent on federal support. And to succeed, we're going to have to mobilize actors across all levels of American life, including states and local communities. With the American Academy coordinating and in partnership with state humanities councils, our commission continues to carry the message out in just this way to sort of local communities. I was incredibly delighted that former Supreme Court Justice David Souter came out of retirement to lead a humanities seminar in Albany, New York at the beginning of September. To my great delight, Carnegie Mellon University, one of the great powerhouses of computer science and technology, introduced the heart of the matter into its freshman orientation program this year. Go Carnegie Mellon. 2 weeks back, I attended an event in Charlotte, North Carolina, honoring support for the humanities by two particularly active civic leaders, and also honoring a local historian who had given over 100 presentations at local libraries, local historical societies on North Carolina histories. 300 people came to that event, and they cheered loud and long, and I left knowing what I actually never do doubt, which is the humanities have plenty of friends if we would take the trouble to remind people of that fact, that they are these friends. Meanwhile, in the wake of the heart of the matter, the American Academy continues to engage in mass dissemination of information, some of which will take the average American quite by surprise. I'm holding up a copy of something called the Humanities Report Card. Here's what you could learn in it. Did you know that 3/4 of American employers want new hires with precisely the sort of skills that humanities teach in critical thinking, complex problem solving, and written and oral communication? No, I didn't know that. That's not what the papers tell me, but actually it is what employers said in a survey. Did you know that humanities majors scored 9% higher than business majors on the graduate management admissions tests? I find this fascinating. You know, it suggests the remote but utterly fascinating possibility that useless things might have their uses after all. And now I turn my eyes on you, members of the College Board Forum. More than 2,000 in number, you are today's evangelizing target in this great cause. When I walked into this room, it looked like a place to have a revival meeting, and now it's just about to begin. I know you are besieged by parents who want to do right by their kids and don't want to be taken in by a scam. I know you know the legitimate concerns and frequent economic pressures that students and their families face. And we all know that colleges don't always make it easy for students to get the glorious experience they've seen advertised, especially when their families don't have the tradition of navigating college and knowing how its value is extracted. There's plenty of work to do to close the gap between the real and the ideal in higher education. We all need to be part of that solution. But for all that, a great harm we can do to today's students is to limit their reach by siding with their anxieties and letting them settle for a form of education that's wanting in ambition. The great question of education today is how to promote the fullest realization of potential in the young men and women who will be the productive and creative citizens of tomorrow, or could be if their education let them. The humanities aren't the whole of the answer, but they certainly are a part of it. The humanities aren't a luxury. They're a core dimension of our humanity and a crucial basis for human power. Your counselors, why don't you go counsel students to build all the sources of their potential strength? That's where the value lies. Thank you. Now, you saw that there are microphones at the front of the room. Those at revival meetings, those are for people who are experiencing conversion to come forward and testify. And if you wish to do that, you could do it. Alternatively, I would take some questions, but you have to step up to the mic to ask one. Come on down. David, shame on you. Are you the head of the only organization of 2,000 people who don't have any questions? Here's one. Oh, but you're a plant. You're from the front row.
That's right. I'm actually also a proud graduate of Duke University.
Excellent.
Where I got my PhD in history.
Perfect. A useful field.
Yes, that's right.
A useful field if you want to understand anything about the world.
Okay. That's correct. Now, you mentioned the role of corporations as being part of the discussions. I've been hearing from Yahoo and so many other corporations, this is what we really need, and it has to do with communication skills,
right,
the ability to understand the wide world, and so on. My question is, what is their willingness to support education in those fields? Because my experience has been that they tend to give to those areas that pertain to, you mentioned Boeing, for example.
To their business, yeah.
So where are we in terms of converting them to the cause?
Well, look, I don't know that I can promise that Yahoo will come to your school with a check, but I do think we understood it's a very important part of this project. Getting 55 people to agree on something, that's not trivial. But then the reason you had such a broad representation was that these people are, you know, they're people who carry credibility in lots of different worlds. And so everybody who was on my commission understood they have a moral obligation to go to their community, their local city, their business community, their education community, and talk up these values. You know, people are making investments in STEM, but they didn't the day the report came out. They did after there was a public self-reminder of things everybody knew and that are all too easy to forget, especially when no one reminds you of them. And I'm gonna have to hope that if we're able to succeed in following Gathering Storm, that the day will come when the humanities will be supported, not in competition with the sciences, I do not favor that at all, but that there'll be a recognition that it's this broad array of human skills that lead to the kind of citizens and workers that our world actually counts on.
Thank you.
Okay. Oh, geez, I know this guy.
President Brodhead. Rick Shaw,
Dean Shaw.
University, yes.
He was my dean of admission for 11 years in a former life.
I learned everything I know from you.
Exactly.
Thank you.
That's what I was thinking.
then the truth will out, yes. One of the things that's a challenge in higher education is the promotion of the humanities across the curriculum. That is, within institutions, there are still kingdoms. And in many cases, the question is, how do you move university faculties to a point where they're far more cooperative in integrating knowledge for students within seminar classrooms and beyond? Okay. That is, how do you get engineers to engage with humanists to talk about their individual fields collectively okay. in training students for the 21st or 22nd century.
I completely agree with you on the importance of this, and I also agree on the challenge of it. Universities hire faculty based on specializations. They hire people based on your willingness in early life to put the blinders on and go way down a narrow alley, and then we ask those people to teach a broad integrative knowledge. It's a challenge for us, to be sure. And I think at pretty much every school, you know, students don't find it natural to mentally specialize. Students are interested in lots of things, and they're interested in putting things together, and often the pressure comes from students in universities. I have to say, I do think that you know every university has faculty for whom their specialization is the limit of the interesting world. But every university has faculty members who have found that they have learned things from unexpected partnerships across universities. One of the things that, of course, we're seeing nowadays is in the digital age, partnerships between history, art history, engineering, computer science that were utterly nonsense 10 years ago are now becoming sort of action points in the university. And I think those those convergences of fields. Well, look at another one, environment. Environment is a scientific-based field, except it's also a policy-based field and thus a social science field. And the environmental movement in this country was first fueled by authors and photographers. So it has an aesthetic dimension to it, too. Putting those things back together in the education of our students, it's a challenge for universities. Our mission is to teach liberal arts education, but our structure is not. The structure of the faculty is the structure of specialization. And so, you know, we need to find out how to get the benefits of that without paying the cost for our students' education. Thank you. An excellent question. I see your powers have not diminished since you went to Stanford so many years ago.
I am over here.
I'm sorry.
I hate to follow the excellent question because mine might not be then. Now I'm very nervous.
I'm coming your way. This will make it even
okay,
more nervous.
Good. I work at a small private school, K-12, and okay. We require art, we require music,
whereabouts is
theater.
It?
It's in Chicago, Francis Parker in Chicago. It's a fabulous place. My daughter actually graduated from Duke.
I mean, you made it sound like Little House on the Prairie, but go ahead.
Okay, no. And my daughter graduated from Duke, which was wonderful, and I wasn't even thinking that when I was standing up here. She absolutely loved it. So I think that probably in this room, you have maybe all the believers in what you just said. I myself was an art major as an undergrad, but I find that I was on the college side for the first part of my life and a counselor on this side. Mm-hmm. Despite the fact that we all believe this, most of us in this room probably don't do what we wish we could do. So for instance, most colleges that I know of will recalculate a grade point average and not calculate art or music or theater or religion or what they might call the soft elective classes.
You're sickening me.
I mean, am I telling the truth? Yeah. So their end, if a student is a senior and they've taken calculus and physics and biology and chemistry, and the senior year they would really like to take maybe then even more English, maybe more art, more history, more music. I myself, again as an art major, believing what you believe, will find myself worried that if they're not taking what looks like the strong science, math extras, they're not going to be admitted to the schools that we think are doing such a good job with them. So help us out here.
You know what? You're never going to solve a problem by pretending it's simpler than in fact it is. Okay, if that is a current fact of our situation, my saying that's not right is really not the solution to it. But I'll tell you that there as there is raised dialogue in this country, you know, I once gave a speech listing examples of people who are at the top of various fields whose undergraduate majors were none of them correlated with the things they've done. That's actually the nature of successful people in the world. We need to carry this message. We live in a very timid, prudent, in quotation marks, world, a world where people don't think they can take risks anymore. Maybe in the old days you could have the liberal arts, but you can't do it anymore. And so now everybody's going to be so prudent that what I've been arguing is that prudence can actually be quite short-sighted, that prudence can be the imprudent way of approaching education. And if we can get that message out in a positive form through colleges and between colleges and secondary schools, you would see a change in that very practice. And when we see a change in that practice, you email me, richard.brodhead@duke.edu, and you can say it's happening. That's a great question. Sir.
Hi. Well, I'd like to take that to the next level, actually.
Uh-oh.
So I'm also a school counselor in Baltimore. I went to one of those big sports-loving universities, majored in a STEMy kind of thing. At least I started out that way. And
why such a self-deprecating biography?
I don't know. I am who I am. This is how I talk. So,
do you see he's even wearing this College Board thing to hide his college affiliation?
No.
Okay.
So, and you are now the leader of a recognized leader in sports as well. So imagine you're Coach K.
Okay.
And instead of representing basketball, you're representing liberal arts and humanities.
Okay.
So now as a school counselor, how do I try to build up a recruit to consider a liberal arts college that, on my perspective, I never even once considered until now that I'm a school counselor, I realize what I missed out on. So how can we do that? How can we try to recruit this army of potential leaders to consider liberal arts colleges and humanities majors?
I tell you, my answer is not going to be too different from the previous one. I think we live in a world that's saturated with information in which certain kinds of truisms are reported and reported and reported. I mean, if you've ever done a study of some of the discussions of indebtedness, for instance, you can find the same half-truths that are reported. You know, all the research you need to do is to read the article that was in X publication yesterday, and then you can report it again the next day. We live in a world of truths and half-truths with a lot of anxiety underwriting it. We need to get out there and be better communicators. I'll tell you one thing, Coach K is a very fine coach, but he is an even better communicator. And maybe what you're saying is, I wasn't sure if your question was, how can I get athletes to be interested in liberal arts? I can answer that question. But how can you get positive, persuasive voices to make people realize that the unobvious choice may just be the right choice? You know, I tried to say this in my talk. It seems to me we live in a time when people just want to be prudent. They want to be prudent. They don't want to make wild, risky choices, but the prudent choice could be the self-limiting choice. And you know, the trouble is, it is said you only have one chance to make your first impression. You actually only have one chance to lay down the foundations of your growing mind. If we can all learn things in later life, but if you don't lay down the foundations for those mental developments early on, it's quite unlikely that a person will be able to do it later on. So we just have to be more serious in this country. I regard this as a question of national interest. I do not regard myself as standing up here arguing for more patience with frivolous subjects. I regard myself as having said, we have a completely insufficient concept of what the array of active ingredients are that make a great education.
Christine Scott, Harlem Achieve is...
I hear you, but I can't see... Where are you?
I've heard that before.
Where are you? Oh, I'm sorry. You have a microphone of your own.
Well.
Whoa.
Thank you. Okay. I just would like you to comment on the fact that when a major technological company mm-hmm. was searching for a new head, their choice was between a big idea person or a technological person. And the comment was that there aren't big idea people out there prepared to lead companies like that.
Well, I can't guess what company you're talking about. I'll tell you, the companies, university presidents, I used to live in the world of English teachers. I now live in the world of all kinds of people who do all kinds of things. And one thing I'll tell you is I mostly hear from business people that they know that someone needs to understand, have the capacity to understand your core business, but that is by no means all the skills they need to have. They need to have imagination. They need to have persuasion. They need to have analytical skills, all kinds of things that are actually founded in far wider places. It's interesting for me, as I say, to think of the people, the head of the National Cancer Institute is a former English major. These are the stories you can really find all over the place. Are we imagining that was an embarrassing deficiency he had to get over? Or are we imagining that somehow that plus something else gave him a wider array of skills? I'm going to guess this the second. Okay, please.
My name's Karen Waples.
And I got to tell you, this is the last question. So make it good.
Wow. No pressure here. I teach at Cherry Creek High School, which is near Denver, Colorado. And one of my concerns is that kids come to me with no history classes in middle school or in grade school because of state standards. And I was wondering what can be done at the state level, in particular with state legislatures, to convince them of the importance of the humanities so that kids know something and are excited when they get to me.
I don't know. You guys know this far better than I, which is, in their wisdom, our public and our elected officials, our school boards, everything else, have tried to make sure people don't not know some things, right? And so you write standards down, but then they squeeze everything else out. But that's not what you had in mind, right? You didn't have in mind that you know this and not that. So I'm not going to pretend the challenge is altogether easy. If you have finite teaching hours, the short teaching day, perhaps you don't regard it as short, but the short teaching day in American K through 12 education, there are things people are tended to skimp on. But it seems to me the only way to get it right, I'm not saying day by day you can get it right, but the only way I know to get any educational problem right is to try to keep in mind what it would look like if you could achieve it. What would education look like at the end of the day? When we launched our report Let's see if I can get this line right. When we launched our report in Washington, it was a very big thing. All kinds of people came from the Senate and the House and everything else. But there was a group of school children who sang a song at the beginning, and it contained a line. I don't know this song. Maybe I'm the only person in the world who doesn't know it. And it was something like, it contained a line, if you want to go somewhere, you've got to do the things you need to get there. And I thought to myself, what more needs to be said? You've got to start with some idea. You know, the goal of education is not to pass this standard or that standard. Those are means to an end. But the easiest thing that happens in education is you convert the end into, you convert the means into the end, as if it were the goal. You got to keep the goal in mind and everything that's needed to help toward the goal. And some days you can get closer to it, and some days further. But I think that we just have to start with a richer concept of the goal of education. You know, there used to be in the world more consensus about what a well-educated person looks like. One of the many forms of progress in our culture is that there's no longer very much consensus about what an educated person looks like. This is actually makes it very hard to be a teacher. It makes it hard to be a parent. It makes it hard to be a student. And one of the things that I actually hope that the Common Core might be is instead of dictating narrowly, you need to know the birthday of Millard Fillmore and Franklin Pierce, that it would represent some idea of what in general are the skills and powers of an educated person and how can one try to develop those things. You know, the powers of education are only developed gradually and through continual input, and I hope that's where we're going to go. You guys are all part of it. I appreciate your patience today. Let's go fight the good fight. Thank you.
Thank you for attending this afternoon's session, ladies and gentlemen. Please join us at 6 p.m. in America's Hall for our networking reception. Thank you.
You're on the phone with your girlfriend. She's upset. She's